Today we're going to be hearing from Tom Mercier. He's actually a BSU alum, so it's a good day for him to be here, homecoming. He then went to Tufts University and graduated with his master's in occupational therapy. He's an adjunct professor at Salem State in their Department of OT, and he is also the director of Assistive Technology Services at the Department of Developmental Services. He's an assistive technology professional, and that's what his presentation is going to be on today. He's going to be speaking about picking the right technology to serve each individual, which is very applicable for all of us because a lot of the students in our clinic may use assistive technology, whether in or outside. So let's all give a warm welcome to Tom.
So let me start by showing you a picture. That's me in 1977, the one with the curly locks and the beard. So I graduated in 1977. I did graduate from the college, actually, not the university. I don't know if that makes that much difference. And I got a call about, speaking at BSC, and I was really excited. I haven't been here since. And so I said, geez, that must have been over 30 years. And I did the math. That was 40 years ago, 1977. So I'm your future. It's okay. Future's all right. All right. So this is what I'm going to talk about. When I speak about assistive technology, people come in, a lot of people have me come and speak about assistive technology. Usually my assumption is that people think I'm going to show fancy things as far as robots and things strapped to legs and fancy wheelchairs, and I work with all that stuff, computer access. I don't do that much of it because I think a lot of that information you can get with the modern technology and everything, you can learn about that piece of it. What I try to do is I try to talk about a philosophy. I try to talk about a philosophy of assistive technology and sort of how I approach the whole idea of assistive technology. Now, I'm supposed to have a slide for this, so you'll have to bear with me. What you have is you're a person and you're going to interact with the environment. You're going to do things in the environment. We all do that. We have to, in order to be able to interact with people, do what we need to do, we're interacting with the environment. So you have me here, over here, you have the world. We're all interacting with the world. Now, for most of us, there's something in the middle that we all have to use in order to interact with. For instance, if we're eating, we have knives and we have forks. We have a table, we have a chair. If we have to go someplace, we may be driving in the car. Or we're walking, so we're using certain types of shoes. We're using computers. Everything that we have to interact with in order to effectively or successfully interact with our environment. Now the people that I work with, the individuals I work with, something happened in their life, either during the developmental years, their adult years, whatever it is, that something happened that makes it either more difficult, makes it more difficult for them to interact with their environment. And so what I look at is I look at that piece in the middle, that piece of assistive technology, and see how I can either give them a piece of assistive technology to make it more effective for them to work with, to interact with their environment, or I look at the piece of assistive technology they have and try to figure out a way to modify it. And what I want to talk about today is how you can actually do that. When I teach my course at Salem State, with the OT students, what I always tell them to do is when they're looking at a situation, you were interacting with your patients, your students, your individuals, and particularly when you're looking at assistive technology, I tell them to take a step back. And take a step back and look at the whole situation and actually analyze what's going on. Now, I've spent hours analyzing how you do things. I've spent 2 hours sitting at my desk thinking about how I put my pants on. Because I have to design something for a young man who can't use his arms effectively and he wants to get himself dressed. And he's 15 years old. And so my job is to try to figure out something that I can make or that I can modify so this gentleman will be able to actually put his pants on. When you're working with the students today, if you start looking at the equipment that they have, you have to take that step back and you have to look and really look at, now, how do I actually do this? How do I go about brushing my teeth? How do I go about feeding myself, getting myself dressed? So that's really what I'm going to talk about. I will show you a few pieces of equipment that I've worked with to kind of explain what I mean. And also I'll give you some references at the other side. All right, and if there's any questions, please, sing right out. So this is me. I figured I'd spend a, I gotta keep an eye on the time. I figured I'd spend a little bit of time, only because it's interesting that I graduated in 1977 with a degree in psychology. And I thought you might find it interesting to find out how I ended up where I am. I really like what I do. I have a really good job. But I kind of weave my way around. So I have a degree in psychology in 1977. What I did was I worked at the direct care. I used to work over at Paul A. Dever. It's not there anymore. It's a state school for the developmentally disabled. It was over in Taunton. Closed years ago. Thank God. But I was at the direct care worker. At one point, I was going to school during the way, working 2 to 11. So I was going to school here and then driving over to Taunton to work 3 to 11. I did that one semester. I was paying my way through school. So I went from direct care worker, I graduated with a degree in psychology, and then became a teacher up at Hogan Regional Center, which is still there. So again, I've worked with an adult, cognitively disabled adult population. I've done that most of my life. So I worked as a teacher. I worked as a teacher and I couldn't stand it. I was a special ed major here at one point, then I switched over to psychology. It turned out I worked as a teacher and I really didn't like the job. So somehow I ended up dropping into this assistive technology world. I got a job as a technician in the adaptive equipment shop, and then became a designer in the adaptive equipment shop. And I did that for about 10 years, and I really liked it. Had no training in carpentry or house building or anything like that. It turns out I had a knack for it. Just learned it as I went along. Did that for 10 years, and then I got bored. So then I ended up getting a degree in occupational therapy. I went to Tufts University, got a master's in occupational therapy. From there, I ended up going in and doing straight rehab. I worked in a long-term care facility. Long-term care facility is a staff OT, and I hated it. I went to get a master's in occupational therapy, and I didn't like it. But I really liked the assistive technology, so I got a job with Invicare Corporation. If you're working with some students over there with wheelchairs, some of them are in Invicare wheelchairs. So it's a major manufacturer of durable medical equipment. So I worked for Invicare Corporation, and my job is to go to the different clinics all over the Northeast, Northeast of the U.S., and sometimes the country, and talk about assistive technology, wheelchairs, beds, CPAP machines, whatever it happened to be, and talk to clinicians about seating and positioning products. So I did that, and ended up working for National Seating and Mobility. National Seating Mobility is a durable medical equipment supplier. Some of the individuals you're working with, the students, we call them individuals in our field. Probably got the chairs from National Seating Mobility. So then I worked for them, and then I ended up coming back to what I did before, which is the Assistive Technology Center. And that's what I do now, I'm the director. The director of Assistive Technology, I end up with 5 centers across the state that I actually coordinate. I travel from here to there. I work with occupational therapists, physical therapists. I have some of those on my staff, but I have designers and technicians on my staff. What happens is there'll be referrals that come in. We'll end up working with the supplier and actually get the equipment. And then actually we have a workshop in the back end. Lathe, wood shop, welders, whatever it is. So anything we can't buy or recommend, we end up building. That's what I used to do, but now I actually coordinate the whole piece. It's just a great job. The field itself is getting very frustrating, but it's a great job. All right, so first I talk about a little bit about occupational therapy. And my theory on occupational therapy, and it lines up and comes into what assistive technology does. What is OT? There's 2 ways to look at occupational therapy. Now, way back when, back in World War I, there was a thing called an activity, I'm going to say activity aid. That's not the right word, but it's an activity aid. What they found was with soldiers coming back from World War I, they had what they called then battle fatigue or physical disabilities. It was World War I, it was actually a very nasty war. And what they found was if they used occupation or doing something as a therapy tool. The old idea of an OT being a basket weaver, have you ever heard that term? All right, so what it was they found that they could, instead of having somebody do exercises, they would have them work and maybe weave baskets. or maybe if they're working on balance, they would have them doing an activity that they would naturally start working on their balance instead of actually doing an exercise. That was what occupational therapy was. Now, the other part of occupational therapy has to do with using occupational therapy to address occupation. Occupation is defined as anything that you do, just like the list of things I talked about before. Washing yourself, dressing yourself, taking care of your kids, going to work, getting up in the morning, trying to catch the bus, whatever it is, sitting in a chair, whatever it is, whatever you do, you occupy your time. Even sleeping is an occupation. So what occupational therapy does, and as an occupational therapist, what I do is I look at everything that someone does, and I have to analyze it. And I have to analyze it because I have to figure out a way for that person to be able to go back to what that occupation is. I have to figure out either a piece of equipment, or as an OT, I have to figure out a way, a workaround, in order for them to be able to do what they need to do. Or say, you're not going to be able to do that, but you can do this activity instead. So you modify activities, you're trying to find equipment in order to help them with that activity, whatever it is. So, that's occupational therapy. This is assistive technology. Assistive technology is any item, piece of equipment, or product system, whether acquired commercially or off-the-shelf, modified or customized, that is used to increase, maintain, or improve functional capabilities of individuals with disabilities. I've read that probably 100 times. I still don't know what it means exactly. That is the official definition, probably put out by RESNA, which is the governing body of assistive technology. If you look at the last part right there, that's used to increase, maintain, or improve functional capabilities of individuals with disabilities. That's the part you have to look at. If you look at my example, which is I'm here, the world's over there, there's something in the middle, that's a piece of assistive technology. And what we have to do, we have to figure out how to modify it, how to get another piece, whatever it is, in order for them to be able to increase or maintain what they want to do in the world. These are the types of assistive technology that I work with. Really quickly, seating and positioning systems. The seating and positioning systems that I work with are very complicated. Everything, every little piece of it is a very specific decision. My occupational therapist, or when I'm doing the seating eval, the cushion is a very specific decision. The back is a very specific decision. The lateral supports, the footrest, all those components, every one of them, there's a decision on why I went with that. There's thousands of different types of, different types of cushions. And there's a reason that I would pick one cushion over another cushion through my evaluation. Same thing with the headrests, the backs, the wheelchairs, why one wheelchair works better than the other, different brands. They might be the same thing, but I'm going to pick one brand over another. Seating and positioning system, and the mobility systems I just touched on too, as far as what that wheelchair, power chair, manual chair, whatever it is, what all those components have to be in order to make the person as functional as possible through all the different things that everybody needs to do and wants to do. Environmental control units, that has to do with turning lights on and off, controlling TVs, controlling whatever it is. It's getting much easier now that we have everything computer controlled, where everything just can be programmed, either through a smartphone. But there's still very specific reasons why you have to go one way versus the other, which I'm going to touch on. Computer-assisted technologies, OCOM communication systems, sensory aids, hearing, vision, for the classroom and the work settings. All these things will go into that, but sometimes in the classroom and the work settings, what you start looking at is more organizational type of things, either educational pieces in order for someone to learn more effectively or be able to organize their work, and the same thing with the work settings, trying to look exactly what they need to do for a task and figuring out a piece of equipment that's going to allow them to do their task effectively. And then the reach of the toothbrush in the toilet. I always put this down at the end because all these things are really good, but if you can't get yourself on and off the toilet, then you're not going to be able to work. What happens with my job is I'm doing a lot of this, and it seems they call it low tech, but it's not unimportant tech. These are the things, this is sort of where the rubber meets the road. This is where a lot of people struggle with, And with all the assistive technology you see out there in the world, sometimes this gets ignored. And this is really where you end up meeting a lot of people, as an OT, as a physical therapist, or as a, or even as a teacher, whatever it is. A lot of the day-to-day things that are really important that all of us take for granted. All right, so just an example of some things I do. This is a tilt chair, a tilt manual chair. We'll talk about it a little bit later. So I already spoke a little bit about this. If I, this is the type of chairs that we're usually working with, the individuals that come into our clinic. They're very involved physically. So we have to make sure that all of this is correct. And with the way that insurance is going right now, it's getting harder and harder to get the technology that's out there into the hands and the seats of the people that need it. And we work a lot with this. We have clinics all over the state. And my occupational therapist, physical therapist, actually evaluate, work with the vendor, and then get this equipment. And then when it breaks down, the technicians and the designers in the back will fix it. Or if, say, does that have a headrest on it? That headrest right there, say that headrest wasn't correct. If that headrest was the best we could do commercially, my designer would take that apart and rebuild it. Cut it up, add some foam to it, would upholster it. Whatever we need to do, even make a new headrest. So I have a whole new bracket. We'd be able to bend the metal, weld it, and make a custom headrest if we had to do it. Always go commercial first, but then when commercial doesn't work, my designers can build whatever they need to build. They're actually much better at it than I ever was. I'm a little bit jealous, but that's all right. They do what I ask. Next thing. Okay. This right here is we do a lot with safety. We have individuals that are living at home, either with their parents or in a group home, maybe by themselves. This right here is just an example stove guard. You put this in, and what will happen is if somebody walks away from the stove and they're away for 5 minutes, it'll automatically turn the stove off. So it's just an example of the safety pieces that we do. A lot with that, people living there trying to do alarms, trying to do different types of sensors, how to get up in the morning, and they may be hard of hearing, so you end up with what's called a bed shaker. You end up with a vibrator under the mattress that will actually vibrate the mattress, and that's the way they get awoken. All kinds of different pieces of safety. And then this is kind of a piece. This gentleman, he had an accident in high school and ended up being in a wheelchair, and his friends from high school wanted to take him sledding. So we ended up building one. Couldn't figure out another way to do it, so we just took his chair and actually made this piece right there. He didn't get hurt more than him. He has some wild friends, but they got him out there. All right. So role of an AT professional. I looked at this slide and I said, yeah, I want to read the whole thing. If you go back to the idea of what I'm doing as an AT professional is I'm trying to look at all the components of what that piece of equipment is going to do and what it needs to do and what kind of situations it's going to be in. So if you look at first, I'm a collaborator. Now, I'm an occupational therapist. And for people interested in occupational therapy, I think occupational therapy is a great, an occupational therapist is a great person to be in the role as an AT professional. PTs will disagree with me. But what it is because occupational therapy and the way that I've approached this is they're supposed to be looking at all the components of the disability. So when you start looking at assistive technology, that's what you have to do. You have to look at all the components and what's going to go into this piece of equipment. The wheelchair might fit the person very well, but how are we going to get it into the car? And who has to fold it? Do they need to fold it? What weight is it? Right? Even with things like toothbrushes, where exactly is that toothbrush going to go? If I've modified a toothbrush, how is a person going to actually get that in their hands? If I figured out, I have to go like second and third step. So we evaluate, recommend, and justify the need for assistive technology. The justify is getting crazy now. Insurance is, I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen with it. Medicare is just getting worse and worse. I didn't think so when I was 1977, but Pretty soon I'm looking at Medicare and I'm already getting nervous. So just trying to get durable medical equipment taken care of is just very difficult. So this piece here is very important because we might identify what they need as far as the evaluation and recommend, but the justification is what my OTs and my PTs really have to work on. And I work on from a different point of view. And then this, consider the context activity demands. Again, we have to walk through all that with AT. Because a number of times, we end up in a situation, my department, maybe me, and someone will call up and say, I have this new wheelchair, and I just got it, and it's not working for me. And what we found is a PT or an OT has actually bought the wrong wheelchair. And once they've bought the wrong wheelchair, the wrong piece of equipment, particularly an expensive piece of equipment, it's very hard to go back upstream because of the payers. It's not like, oh, I bought the wrong size shirt, I can return it. It's not going to work that way. So what we find is you've got to make sure that everything is correct prior to actually getting the chair. All right, so AT is simple. These are the things that I look at, and this is my philosophy. It has to do with stopping and knowing who the person is that you're working with, look how simple, how something works and how it doesn't, and be observant, and then keep it simple. First right here, know your patient, know your student, know who you're working with. You start looking at diagnoses. Multiple sclerosis is different than cerebral palsy, which is different than ALS. Right? So when I'm doing my thing, I have to know where the person's coming from, because I have to know what the piece of equipment is. For instance, multiple sclerosis. If I'm working with someone who has multiple sclerosis, I know about the disease, and I also know that there's different types of multiple sclerosis. Multiple sclerosis, sometimes you can have what's called an exacerbation, which is a tingling of the arm, losing the use of one arm, finding that you can't walk, you wake up one day and just can't walk. So there's an exacerbation. But what I find out is that how severe the exacerbation was, but also how many have you had over the last year. So we get a handle on what the MS is doing. Some people can have multiple sclerosis and function very well, meaning they won't have any kind of significant disability for years, even the span of their lifetime. Other people can have multiple sclerosis and they can actually start having exacerbations and their function can change radically over a year or 2 years. So I have to figure out where that person is in that timeline or in that type of MS and design my equipment as such. Cerebral palsy is somewhat a stable condition, but it can change as people age somewhat. ALS is a lot different. For people who have what would be more of a typical ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease, then when I'm working with someone in a wheelchair clinic, I'm working very, very fast because I'm trying to catch up to the disease. I'm trying to get them equipment prior to them actually needing more equipment. So when I start looking at equipment, I'm either actually ordering a power wheelchair, even if the person can propel the chair. Because I know that with ALS, in a year, they're going to need a power chair. See what I mean? So knowing the diagnosis, vital statistics, age, weight, employment, cognitive, family, all this is important. Most of it I can pick up. I have to see whether they want to be employed. They're still being employed. Cognitive, physical, as far as how they can handle the pieces of equipment. And then family. And what the family thinks and how the family thinks about assistive technology is very important for me. Environment, where the piece is going to be used, and then, again, where it's going to be working, and then the patient's goals. You've got to make sure you know what the patient's and the family goals are. If you're working in any kind of a people profession, teaching, psychology, assistive technology, occupational therapy, the patient's goals are very important. The patient's goals may differ from what your goals are, but you have to make sure that the patient and your goals mesh enough, or you've justified your goals to the patient so they understand them in order for anything to work. I can have somebody have the best chair in the world, and we've done it, we've had them have equipment, but if either mom doesn't like it, always pay attention to mom, mom doesn't like it, or the patient doesn't like it, what happens is the piece of equipment ends up being in a closet. They won't use it. They'll go back to their old wheelchair. So you always got to make sure you have that tie-in. Okay. So, how some of it works and how it doesn't work. This haunts me most days of my life. I was driving, dropping off my youngest boy. It was the Rockport High. I'm in traffic, and I look over, and there was a American Legion hall on the right-hand side. I was waiting at a light. And I looked over, and I said, that ramp isn't the code. There was a wheelchair ramp there. I said, geez, that ramp isn't the code. And I walked through my life looking at things like that, saying, you know, as a matter of fact, I checked out the building here, and I didn't notice the ramp at all. I'm saying, well, this place better be wheelchair accessible. And I started playing with the doors in here. I had just come in, and I started playing with the doors, kind of looking at how they open, and how easily they open, how hard they might be. And also I wondered, and I'm not right or wrong about this, but I wondered because you can, it's a large door, and you've got a handle, so you've got to pull the handle open. Is there a button? Is that automatically open there? It does, okay, all right, good. I didn't see that, which is interesting, I couldn't find it. Just looking to see exactly how it opens and closes. Now, I look at things and look how they work all the time. This right here is an example of, it's got a glass with juice in it, and that piece holds that straw there. And that straw is a bendy straw. Now, if you had a choice between straws, somebody was going to give you a straw, said, would you like a straight straw or a bendy straw? How many people would choose a bendy straw? Cool, aren't bendy straws cool? I mean, those are cool. I remember when they didn't have bendy straws. So everyone would go with a bendy straw. I know it's only a straw. But if you look at the way this would work, you see you've got a piece coming up through the liquid, and liquid is the nice lubricant. It comes up and they have that vent at a 90-degree angle. Now these are coming out of catalogs. People are trying to sell that piece that clips onto the glass. Now one thing is I don't like the idea of that alligator clip clipping onto a piece of glass. If you ever had an alligator, and I've done this, an alligator clip like that doesn't clip onto glass very well, right? Because it'll catch, but it'll kind of move a little bit, so that's a little unstable. Now, with the bendy straw, the problem with the bendy straw, if I've got a glass, say I have this and I have a bendy straw in here. So I have a certain disability or a certain physical makeup that what happens is I hang on to it and I actually pull this way toward my mouth in order to take a drink. All right? What's going to happen to that bendy straw? It's going to go that way. All right? So, and even if I'm up level, I'm going to have to do this and wait for the bendy straw to come back this way. All right? And then when I come up to it like this, have you ever tried that? Maybe you're paying attention to something else? Yeah. And the bendy straw starts working, so you can only play the straw. Now, it's amusing to watch, but it can frustrate the bejeebers out of you. So, the idea of using that and using a bendy straw, it seems like a simple thing. Everybody would like the bendy straws, right? Bendy straws are cool. But this is going to be a better solution. All right? A straight straw. This is probably going to be a better solution for the person because then they're able to move it like that. So these are just straws. Now, I'm going to a point here. But I look at all kinds of things like this, and these are the things that a lot of people don't look at and wondering why somebody may not be able to do something, all right? And assistive technology, it doesn't matter if it's this, a bendy straw, or it's a power wheelchair that can cost, I sold one time for $30,000, they're going higher than that. It doesn't matter, it's still the same principle, which is you have to look at things, you have to look at how things work, and you have to look at how people interact with all the things in our world. Now, this is another straw. This is a cool straw. Now, if you've got somebody who's sitting at a desk, say they're sitting, and they can't pick this up, so they're going to use a straw. Now, they sell straws that are about this long, so that makes sense. You put it in there, and then you'll be able to go from there, and you can suck it up, right? Has anyone ever tried to suck anything up through a long tube? Probably no one's ever tried to siphon gas, have they? Yeah, okay. So, what happens, though, is if somebody's trying to suck the liquid up there, when you let go, the liquid falls back down. So what you're doing is you're sucking. You get a drink, you let go, and the water goes back down. So now you're hauling it up the hill again. You see what I mean? It's like, so what this does is this right down in here, And I'll let them bulk this special so I wouldn't have to walk back and forth to see if it works. Beautiful. Now, this piece right here, all right, right in there, that actually is a one-way valve. So what happens is this is a very long straw, but when you suck this up, the water comes all the way up and it stays there because this is a one-way valve. It's a cool little thing. So what happens is you can have this straw pretty much as long as you want it to, but once they bring this all the way up the hill, water stays up the hill. See what I mean? You have to kind of look and see how things work. Now, when I start talking about high-end stuff, wheelchair right here. Now, this is what you call your standard wheelchair. Is that meant to care? If you look at this right here, I start looking at wheelchairs. This is your standard wheelchair. We had a situation the other day that an individual was going to get a wheelchair, and somebody went on Amazon and just bought him a wheelchair. That type of thing drives us crazy because we knew the person was eligible for a wheelchair through their insurance, but somebody that frustrates them will just get them a wheelchair. So they got them one of these. All right. Now, if you look at this wheelchair, when I start looking at a wheelchair, right there, these are what's called full-length armrests. Full-length armrests are good for some people, according to what their posture is. But if I'm trying to get up to a table, I don't want full-length, I want desk-length. Because this full-length right here, if I get up to a table and it bumps up against the table, that means I have to lean forward in order to try to do something at the table. All right? Swing seat. You don't want a swing seat. With a swing seat, have you ever sat in what's called a director's chair or a lawn chair or something like that? I guarantee you, you'll be sitting in that thing, and after about 5 minutes, you'll do the little side thing. You'll swing over that. Because you're not comfortable this way, so you'll shift your hip one way or the other way. So you don't want people who are sitting in a chair, even for a little bit of the day, to be in a chair like that, because that ends up affecting the posture over time. The leg rest. The leg rest right here, these are what's called that's a 60-degree leg rest. That's a standard in the industry. But if I have tight hamstrings, and now a lot of the elderly using wheelchairs will have tight hamstrings, and they can't do this. They're more like that. If I give them 60-degree hangers, what happens is they sit in this chair, and then I bring their feet to the footrest. They have tight hamstrings. It's like me trying to sit down and doing a straight leg out, sitting down. I can't do it. So what happens is they end up sliding out of the chair, and then everybody says, "Well, I wonder why Agnes is always slumped in the chair." Because you're trying to give a range of motion in the legs using the footrest. All right? Wheels. This is an 8-inch wheel. An 8-inch wheel is really good because it can go over rougher surfaces. That has to do with just the circumference of the wheel. It's going to go over bigger rocks because it's a bigger wheel. All right? But the problem with the wheel is that if it's too big, the spin of it may end up running into the person's feet, so I may need lower wheels. But if I need to change the seat to floor height, that's from here to here, I want to go with smaller wheels. But I can't go too small, because if I go too small, they're going to end up running into ruts and maybe tip over. The back wheel, this is a 24-inch wheel. That's an industry standard. But you might want to go lower again to lower the seat to floor height. This right here is a fixed axle. It doesn't give the person a very good relationship as far as them being able to propel the chair. So I end up going with more of a higher-end chair. I can take this axle and I can bring it forward. That axle will do a couple things. One is it'll bring it forward, give them better access to the wheel. But also, if you look at what it ends up doing is you bring this axle forward, you end up with more weight behind the wheel, and that lightens up the front end. What that means is when I'm propelling the chair, I'll actually almost bounce over more of those ridges and everything. So when somebody's using the chair long term, a wheelchair, you'll end up bringing the wheels forward like that in order for them to make it more accessible. See? So, if I'm looking at this, and I'm in assistive technology, and I'm thinking about going to being a clinician, then what I have to do is I have to keep on looking at how everything works, and how one thing may affect another thing, in order to actually get the right piece of equipment. Another example is this. This is a power wheelchair. What I look at with power is that this gentleman is positioned very well. Well, what I do is I call a thing that's called access to power. No, access to control, and then the control of the access. What I have to make sure is the person is able to actually control the chair or wherever the joystick might be. It works like. I think he's working that wheelchair from some switches on his tray, is what he's doing. So what I have to do is I have to make sure these switches are where they're supposed to be. And make sure that it can actually control the chair and make sure there's so many switches. Now, the way it works now is with the computer processor on board, which of course has been around for a number of years, is not only do I have to make sure that when he hits one of these switches that the chair actually moves, but then what I can do is I can tweak it in order to make sure the chair will move smoothly. I can change the turning radius, I can change the acceleration, the deceleration, I can have it pause, I can put it on what's called a, I can put it so when he hits a button and he wants to go straight, so he's going straight down an aisle, he'll just hit the button and the chair will just continue to go. It's called latched. It can be a latch control, so what that means, he just presses it once and he'll go down the aisle. He doesn't keep on pressing that button. The reason I might want to do that, because he might get fatigued with doing what he's doing, or he might be doing something else. And then all I can do is just hit the right and left, and he'll just be able to, just navigate it that way. So I need to work on and see exactly what this gentleman needs to do, what his activities are, in order to match all the electronics up to what he needs to do. Sometimes what happens is people will give people too much electronics, and I have to actually, poor term, but dumb down the electronics, meaning not give him so much electronics that ends up being difficult for him to figure out things that he doesn't need. All right. This here is a, this must be an old AOL page, the one I pulled off the internet, of course. Now, I was working with a gentleman, no, young lady, excuse me. Young lady, she was totally blind, and she was working, and she was using a computer, and had a program on it called JAWS. And what it is, it's a text-to-speech software. And so when this page comes on, it reads everything on the page. So the way she was actually manipulating through the internet was she using Morse code. She has two switches. And she learned Morse code, and so she'd be able to type in what she wanted to search for. Then she had a couple other ones as far as being able to scroll through the pages. That was working fine. Now what JAWS does, the program JAWS, is it'll read everything on the page. So when she, and she had AOL as a provider. I don't know who has AOL for a provider, but she still had AOL. So it would come onto this page, and the problem with JAWS is it read everything. So it started right up the top. Web, images, virus, news, and it would go on and on. See what I mean? So the program, the JAWS program was good. She could get access to the computer, get access to the web page, but the web page wasn't working for her. She just needed the search engine. We got her off AOL, which is actually quite difficult, and put her on Google, and then gave her this for a home page. You see what that does for her? See, so all the technology was there, but we had to modify it in such a way so that way when she gets on, all it's doing is reading this. And then when it gets down to the search bar, she's able to click it, and then she can put her search in. Right? It's just a matter of looking exactly what somebody needs to do. All right. Be observant. Told you things drive me crazy, and I'm getting crankier as I get older. Now, this right here is a washroom, which is in Natick, I think. I think this is a library in Natick. I went to a meeting there. Now, if you look at what you have, you've got sink, and right there is your towel dispenser. Now, this is a handicapped accessible washroom. So, there is the towel dispenser for somebody in a wheelchair. Anyone see what's wrong with this picture? Why things drive me crazy? All right, I'm in a wheelchair and I'm washing my hands, all right? I have to wash my hands and with my wet hands, hold onto my wheels, wheel myself over and use that dispenser. Now, I have to use my hands in order to actually get over there. It's not like I'm walking so I can just walk over with mine. I'm not touching anything, see what I mean? So, whoever did this went by what the law would be, which is we have a handicapped accessible washroom and we have a towel dispenser that someone can use at a wheelchair height. But you see what I mean? They didn't take the extra step as far as really looking at it and trying to figure out how somebody would use it. When you're working with your students today and they're working with different pieces of equipment or they're doing some kind of an activity and you look that they're having difficulty with it, what I find people have difficulty with is taking that step back and really looking at the situation and doing what we call in OT world a task analysis and looking and see exactly how I would go about doing this activity. The other thing I look at is how to do it differently. Meaning, there was another thing in design courses that I took, and it has to do with the idea of brainstorming. And what I talk about with brainstorming has to do with looking at things from different angles and really coming up with the strangest ideas. It has to do with that gentleman that I'm trying to get him to wear his, be able to put his own pants on. I've tried all kinds of different ways to actually have somebody put their own pants on. Can he do it lying down? Can he do it upside down? Is there some way I can get him upside down so that gravity can help? It's all odd ideas, but with these odd ideas, what happens is you end up coming up with an idea. You have to take a step back and look and see what's going on. We're at 9 o'clock. This one here, this isn't the right slide that I wanted to show you, but see right here, this is handicapped spaces. See this one right here where nobody's supposed to park because someone's supposed to come from this chair, from this car, and be able to use this ramp? There's a parking lot in Beverly. Actually, I stopped there to get a tea on the way by. And what they did was they actually have handicapped spaces, but right where this ramp is right here, they have a regular parking space. So where the ramp is, where the curb cut is for somebody to use that as a wheelchair, there's actually a regular parking space there. I've gone in and talked to the owners a couple of times. It's like, do you understand that we're well within the law? We put everything in, we have the handicapped spaces. He said, yeah, but if you have a regular parking space there, somebody parks it, nobody can use the curb cut. All right, let me quickly go through this. I won't go there, okay. And I'm not gonna go there. Too bad, it's a good story. All right. This is something I modified one time for somebody in the nursing home, actually. Is they had to be able to press a button. There's a little button there, but they didn't have the strength in order to push here. So what I had to do was think of a different way to do it. Instead of pushing, if they could grab something. So what I did was I took a tongue depressor, some tape, and actually put a little broken piece of tongue depressor right under there. So what I did was I converted the action into a grab versus a press. It's just the idea of looking at something, right? Not big engineering, but boy, they were really happy because then they had actually some way to call the nurse during the weekend. Then they ended up getting a regular switch, but this was a Friday afternoon. All right. Some of the places, if you're interested in either OTPT, Assistive Technology, RESNA. RESNA is Rehab Engineering Society of North America. Everything there is to know about assistive technology as far as the field itself, is in RESNA, just RESNA.org. All right, I'll go on the website, but we're running out of time. So let me, Assistive Technology Professional, they're the ones that do the tests for that. This one here, that's MassMatch. That's in Massachusetts. If you go onto this site, you'll learn a lot about assistive technology, services that are available. They have an equipment center as far as equipment you can get for free. Equipment loan program. Just about anybody that's involved in assistive technology in the state is on this one here, massmatch.org. If you have a chance, the Abilities Expo, I think it's every 2 years. I don't think it's every year. If it happened this year, it's in Boston. It's free. It costs you $15 to park. It's over by the Expo Center. But anybody in industry, and it's really for consumers. We have a lot of consumers go in there. So if you're interested in equipment, just general equipment, it's a great afternoon to go to. And then, last but not least, me. That's James. James is now 14. That's my number and that's my email. And I love talking. My wife will tell you I love talking. I love talking to students. You end up, any kind of questions, you know, occupational therapy, assistive technology, you went into a problem, I tell this any time I lecture. You can always get a hold of me, give me a call, and I'll help out the way I can. If you're interested in it and you want to come up and either visit the clinic here, up in Danvers, Grantham, anything like that. All right? Okay. 9 o'clock.
We have some time for questions. We have
Okay. Any questions for anyone? Yeah.
How long, like, from start to finish does it take to, like, get an individual a custom wheelchair?
It's usually taken, they say 6 to 12 weeks. It's going to take at least 12 weeks. But what's happening, a lot of my job right now is a frustrating part, is trying to work in Medicare and MassHealth. And again, I've said it a couple of times, it's just getting crazy. It can be held up. People could be waiting 6 months because they don't have one piece of paper. And I tell you, the way it is right now, Medicare, I think it's just looking for that angle in order to put off buying things. So it's very frustrating. It'll work with a good dealer and work with a good clinician. It takes a long time. That's why you got to be careful on the front end as far as making sure that the equipment is correct. Someone else?
What is the most high-tech thing that you've had to design
to? Right now, we're working a lot more with computer access. But frankly, I don't know a lot about it. I mean, I can use a computer. I can use a smartphone. But some of my other designers are doing that. He's worked on a couple pieces. He's actually made his own boards in order to actually have an early warning system for some individuals that are in houses that we have to work on. I'm trying to work on something right now on an early warning system. And I come up with the ideas and I find people that actually do the work. It's a great job. What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to figure out a way for, because they have what's called house monitoring systems, where you can have vibration monitors and cameras and put them into a home, and if somebody lives by themselves, when their routine changes, meaning they don't get up in the morning and the vibration wasn't there from the floor prior vibration, mom didn't get up in the morning, then what happens is the service will actually call a daughter or a son and say, it looks like the routine has changed. Did I explain that well? It monitors the apartment or the house that the person is in. What I'm trying to work on is an idea where we can actually observe someone who has autism and observe them during the day and try to get the right type of monitors for us to try to see what behavior precedes them actually trying to bolt for the door or do some other type of behavior we don't want them to do. But it's not just the idea of monitoring like an alarm. What I'm trying to do, and I'm working with someone that actually worked with me years ago, that got a degree in computer engineering, I'm trying to work on the idea of being able to analyze those movements and those behaviors in such a way that we get a real early warning system. So that's probably one of our more high-end pieces. And the wheelchairs and the power chairs and everything are getting more and more complicated as far as what they can do. But what I'm trying to have my department do is more work more into that piece of it. We've been doing seating and positioning and more of that for years and years. So I'm trying to work up to that. And again, I have people that work for me that have the ability to move in that direction. I just have to point to that. Yes?
So most of your things go through insurance, but are there additional prices that people have to pay in order to get these assistive technology devices?
Yeah. There's a couple of things that happen. One thing is when people come and work for we work for people who are being serviced by Department of Developmental Services. If they come to our shop, our Assistive Technology Center, if it's commercially available, we try to get it paid for. If it's not commercially available, then we build it, and they don't pay for that. The Commonwealth, your taxes, are paying for us to build something using materials. So we have that advantage right there. And yes, they can pay for it, but the frustrating is the convoluted way that we have our insurance right now is I've actually had situations where someone wanted to pay for something but couldn't, because the way that the legislation is that somebody has Medicare and MassHealth. If they have MassHealth, sometimes they can't buy it because nobody in the state who's a MassHealth provider can actually sell it to them. It has to do with the way that the laws are. It's odd. There's ways to get around it, meaning there's not ways to get around it. There's ways to resolve it, but sometimes I've been in situations where there is a piece of equipment out there that someone just can't get because it has to do with the way that the coverage is. But yes, there's things that you can do. There's some things that aren't covered. ceiling lifts can be covered sometime by MassHealth, but if you don't have MassHealth, they're expensive. Somebody might do something like that. Home modifications aren't usually covered. Ramps, that type of thing. Even with private insurance, you have to end up paying for those. But there are funds available, you can get low interest loans in order to get home modifications taken care of. Yes?
Designers in your shop, do they also have OT backgrounds, or are they just like engineering?
Mostly engineering. I'm kind of a mixed bag. If somebody who has a degree in computer engineering, someone else who has a degree in architecture, a couple designers, somebody from Rhode Island School of Design years ago. I have one person that actually has a high school education, but he's been a tech for years and he's learned the job. Usually when I'm interviewing for, I'm looking at engineers, designers. But really what I'm looking for is a really big combination because, not to slight engineers, but sometimes engineers kind of look, they're not a people person, that might be why they're engineers. So I have to get a really interesting combination where I have to have somebody who can really interact with people and draw out individuals and get information and also be able to do the design piece. And I don't see a combination. But now I'm trying to get people that, again, can do the things that I can't do. They know more about materials, they know more about computer access and how exactly to get that done. So it's a combination, but mainly I'm looking at designers. Anyone else?
Probably take like one more question. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
With regards to the creation of equipment, what piece of equipment would you say you were integral in the creation of that you most proud of?
Let me see. I know I have one. I have it. We did end up actually one of the shops, the renting shop actually was the first people that actually had it made a tilting space wheelchair. They cut a chair apart and made a tilting space wheelchair, and now it's an industry standard as far as that goes. I did end up working with somebody. This is the type of thing, it's nothing I made, but we're in a position to actually help somebody that we knew. Somebody that was a friend of one of the OTs that worked in the shop and everything, who had, her husband had a brain tumor. And we ended up being able to piece together a tilt chair that we had, one that somebody had used, and it was a free one. And we were able to put all that equipment together and actually give them a chair that they weren't able to get on their own. And being able to do that actually allowed this gentleman to actually go out and spend time with his family outside and out on the deck and actually sunshine. He's passed away since then. But it's that type of thing that I just, working in this field, working in human services, education, that type of thing, I just don't know how anybody wouldn't want to do it. I mean, you know people who don't work in this field. And the idea of going to work every day and thinking about I'm going to be able to go help somebody and actually really impact somebody's life. So it's kind of a combination of things. But I've been very blessed that I'm able to do what I can do.
All right, well, on behalf of the clinic, we'd like to give you a shirt, one of the black shirts that our senior staff has.
Mm-hmm.